JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for November the 3rd. I am Charalambos, Pissouros, head of research here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded higher against all the other major currencies on Tuesday during the Asian session Wednesday, gaining the most versus NZD, AUD and CHF. The currency that lost the least ground was JPY. Now, the broader strength of the US dollar and the good performance of the yen, combined with the fact that the Kiwi and the Aussie were the main losers, suggests that markets may have turned to risk off at some point yesterday and today in Asia. Indeed, this happened during the Asian session today. European shares were mixed yesterday, while Wall Street hit fresh record highs once again. Today in Asia, besides Japan's Nikkei, which stayed closed and due to a holiday, all the other indices under our radar slid, and this may have been due to investors turning more cautious today ahead of the FOMC decision. That said, let's not forget the uncertainty surrounding China's economic outlook, the nation's property sector, due to which Asian equities have been underperforming their EU and US counterparts recently. Now, today, all the market attention is likely to fall on the FOMC decision, scheduled for later in the afternoon. When they last met, US policymakers kept their policy untouched, but in the statement accompanying the decision, it was noted that if progress continues broadly as expected, the committee judges that the moderation in the pace of asset purchases may soon be warranted. What's more, the new dot plot pointed to 9 members in favor of rate increases to start next year, and 17 supporting higher rates in 2023. Remember that back in June, the respective numbers were 7 and 13. So, since the latest gathering, several policymakers have been adding fuel to expectations over a November tapering start, while the better-than-expected earnings results suggested that the US economy was not affected by the latest bottlenecks, as many may have believed. So this, combined with the fact that inflation continued to accelerate in September, well above the Fed's objective of 2%, I think it stood at 5.4%, allowed market participants to consider a tapering start at this meeting as a done deal, and to bring forth their bets with regards to the first interest rate hike. According to the yields of the Fed Fund futures, they now nearly fully price in a 25 basis points hike to be delivered in September 2022, while a few weeks ago such a move was expected in the first months of 2023. So with all that in mind, we do expect the committee to begin the tapering process this week. And bearing in mind that at the prior press conference, Chair Powell noted that a gradual tapering process could conclude around the middle of next year, we expect a pace of $20 billion per month. Now, having said all that, though, given that the tapering is largely anticipated by the financial community, all the attention is likely to fall to the statement accompanying the decision and Powell's press conference for comments on inflation and hints on interest rates. Anything suggesting that inflation could stay elevated for longer than previously anticipated and that interest rates could start rising soon after the tapering is over could support the US dollar. The opposite may be true in case policymakers try to push back against interest rate pricing. Now, the big question is how the equity market will react. Will it slide on signals of faster rate hikes, which could hurt profitability of firms, or will it rise as this could mean that the US economy is performing better than many may have recently feared due to the latest supply shortages? In our view, although the former has been the case in the past, we believe that lately it's been the latter. Thus, anything suggesting that the Fed is confident to keep withdrawing monetary policy support following a start today may allow equity investors to buy more. After all, they may have already digested the idea that interest rates will start rising at some point soon. Now, as for the rest of today's events, during the early Asian session today, we already got New Zealand's employment report for the third quarter. The unemployment rate declined by more than expected, while the employment change accelerated faster than thought. Only the labor cost index fell short of matching its forecast, but still it was higher than in the second quarter. In our view, those numbers paint a positive picture and increase the case of and increase the likelihood of more interest rate increases by the RBNZ soon. Now, later in the day, we have the final market services and composite PMIs for October from the UK and the US, as well as the ISM non-manufacturing index for the same month. The final market prints are expected to confirm their initial estimates, while the ISM index is anticipated to have increased to 62.1 from 61.9. The ADP employment report is also coming out, and the forecast points to a slowdown to 400,000 from 568,000. Now, with regards to the energy market, we have the Energy Information Administration report on crude oil inventories for last week. The forecast points to a 2.225 million barrels built after a 4.267 million increase a week before. However, bearing in mind that yesterday the American Petroleum Institute reported a 3.594 million barrels rise, we would consider the risks surrounding the Energy Information Administration number as tilted to the upside. As for the speakers, besides Fed Chair Jerome Powell, who will hold a press conference after the FOMC decision, we will also hear from ECB President Christine Lagarde, ECB Executive Board Member Frank Elterson, and Bank of Canada Deputy Governor Tony Gravel. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 8 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.